So far, we have seen how characters' animations are done in AAA games and how important is it in games to be successful beside the storyline. Motion capture technology is the only solution to bring the reality in character appearance, which creates the appealing factor for the player to drive the game. There are several types of motion capture technologies are being used in game development today, but those are very expensive and unaffordable for indie game developers like me. Therefore, I have decided to make a hybrid motion capture solution for my game. The decision was taken based on my research on how AAA games are making motion capture animation in their RPG games. If you have not watched the previous video, please check the description below. You can also visit the link I have given in the description to read the complete research paper. My motion capture solution is based on inertial motion capture solution to record character or actor's gesture. For 3-axis local rotation, I will be using accelerometer and gyroscope. And for actual magnetic direction, I will be using magnetometer. For facial expression capture, I will use iPhone app called LiveLink. Finger movements, I will use flex sensors or stress sensors. I'll go step by step to build a solution for better understanding and the problem solving. And hence, this development is broken down in multiple videos under mockup building playlist. Complete design and the source codes will be shared with you in my Patreon site. So without any further ado, let's dive into it now. If you are new to this channel, please consider to give a like and subscribe. That makes a lot to me. To make the mockup suit for character, first we need to understand what we would like to animate. For that, I have chosen human character to start with. The digital human character has minimum of 17 joints. Movement for each joints gives character body motion and change in posture. Each joints has two attributes in 3D space, local rotation and local location. Local location is relative to the previous joint, where local rotation is relative to its own plane. Detailed explanation is given in my previous video. Using sensors, we will be rotating the local rotation. On rotation of the sensor will give the data of its XYZ angle, which I will retarget to my character's specific bone's local rotation. In this video, my target is to get the data out of the sensor first. To achieve that, let's look at the architecture now. All the sensors will be placed on the rigid body, 17 different places. The sensor I am using today is Adafruit BNO055 orientation sensor. Sensor will collect the orientation data in terms of accelerometer, gyroscope, and magnetometer data, which we will collect it and send it to Unreal for retargeting. For finger, I will be using stretch or flex sensor to evaluate the bend. There will be controller to power up the sensors and extract the data. For that, I am using Raspberry Pi 02W. Raspberry Pi will extract the data and send it to the gaming PC over Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. The communication protocol would be UDP. For today, I will connect one BNO sensor with the Raspberry Pi 02W to see and validate the data for the first time. Now, let's look at the component which I need to complete the initial circuit. There are several orientation sensors are available, but I found Adafruit BNO055 sensors are more stable and easier to calibrate. Adafruit BNO055 is an absolute orientation sensor. Bosch is the first company to get this right by taking a MEMS accelerometer, magnetometer and gyroscope and putting them on a single die with a high-speed ARM Cortex M0 based processor to digest all the sensor data. Abstract the sensor fusion and real-time requirement away and spit out data. You can use it in quaternion, Euler angles or vectors. More details on this are added in the description, a link given. These sensors dimension wise 20mm by 27mm and 4mm. The weight of this sensor is only 3 grams and you can see how small is this sensor is. The maximum total weight of the 17 sensors will be 100 grams that include the connector cables and other connection items. The price I paid for the sensor is only $50 Australian. All the data from BNO055 absolute orientation sensor needs to be aggregated to a controller device and then transmitted to a computer for visualization wirelessly. For that, we need a microcontroller or a small computer with inbuilt wireless component like Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. I am choosing Raspberry Pi 02W. This is a wireless module. There are other modules like Arduino Nano can be used for this, but I prefer Raspberry Pi as it is multi-threaded and does support Python programming, which is easier to program. The Raspberry Pi 02W is the next generation in the Pi 0 line that remains as one of the most affordable single board computer in the market. The board incorporates a quad-core 64-bit ARM Cortex-A53 CPU clocked at 1 GHz. More details on this Raspberry Pi 02W are there in the description, a link given. The price I paid for Raspberry Pi 02W is only $25. Other than BNO055 and Raspberry Pi, I will be using Python programming, which is to extract the data from BNO sensor and transmit it to the computer wirelessly. It's free and it is open source. I will be using 4 jumper cables to connect Raspberry Pi with BNO055, a breadboard to stick my BNO055 stable. I paid $6 one time for the breadboard. I need a 32GB micro SD card for Raspberry Pi operating system. I paid $29 for that. With the micro SD card, I need a micro SD card reader. I paid $19 for that. To power up Raspberry Pi, I need a micro USB power cable. Today, I'll be using my Android phone's power cable for that. Normally, it costs $10. I also need a soldering kit to solder the BNO055 and the Raspberry Pi 40 pins. I spent around $140 for that. So all these are one-time charge except the BNO055, which I need 16 more. Now I will configure the Raspberry Pi 02W by downloading the imager from the website and then copy it into the micro SD card. I have put my micro SD card into the micro SD card reader and hooked into the computer USB port. To download the imager, jump into the website. Link is there in the description below. I choose Raspberry Pi OS Lite as it does not include the desktop version. It's a light version. It is faster to boot. Once the image is downloaded to microSD card, now set up the SSH and Wi-Fi configuration to access the Pi wirelessly over my Wi-Fi network headlessly. I'm saying headlessly because to boot and access Raspberry Pi over Wi-Fi, I don't need any monitor, I don't need any keyboard, I don't need any mouse. To do that, I will download 2 files into the microSD card at root. On startup, this file will be read by Pi and connect to my home Wi-Fi, and then I'll be able to SSH to the Pi. You can download these 2 files from the description. Once you copy the file into the root directory of Raspberry Pi, modify the SSID details as per your home Wi-Fi setup. Later, I will implement a process to connect the Pi from the mobile app or from the game console to configure the details via app. In that case, these files are not required to download at the beginning. I'll create a separate video for that later. Now, I will insert the microSD card to Raspberry Pi 02W and then power it on. Once it is boot up, I'll use PuTTY to access the Pi in headless mode. To access the Pi, let's first ping the Pi using ping command raspberrypi.local, or you can go to the router to see IP address of the Raspberry Pi. As I have multiple Raspberry Pi is configured in my network, I had to log into my router to find out the exact IP address to connect. Now I will log into the Pi using the default username Pi and password Raspberry. After logging to the Pi, at first I will change the password. The command is passwd. Now I'll update the firmware using the command given on the screen, or I have added the command in the description below. This will take some time. Please wait till it completes. Upgrade the Pi might take some time and you might face some error like insufficient disk space and so on. For that, go to Raspi config and extend the partition. Once done, reboot the Pi and rerun the commands. Now my Pi is ready, can access it over my Wi-Fi. time to shoulder the Raspberry Pi 02 and Beano 055. I am not expert, this might be the second or third time shouldering any PCBs. For better shouldering guide, please refer to the YouTube videos. I have added the links in the description. Shouldering process is easy, it needs patience. If you are beginner like me, you will mess up little bit, but eventually you will get there. Once both Pi and Beano 055 is shouldered, I place the Beano 055 on the breadboard to handle it better. Now I will set up the I2C tools in Raspberry Pi to access the data from the sensor. I2C, inter-integrated circuit, or we can call it I2C, is a synchronous multi-controller or multi-target packet switch, single-ended serial communication bus. The I2C protocol is used to establish communication between two or more ICs. ICs means integrated circuit. Hence, why it's known as inter-integrated circuit communication. However, it should be noted that I2C could be used as a communication protocol between two ICs that are located on the same PCB. In short, when you need to establish short distance communication within the same board or device, you can use I2C. It requires only two bidirectional wires for transmitting and receiving information. You also need to know that I2C protocol supports serial communication only. The protocol is very popular and multiple peripheral ICs are connected in master and slave configuration. Talking about master and slave configuration, you have a lot of flexibilities when it comes to using the I2C protocol. I2C allows designers to establish two-way communication between multiple ICs and slave ICs. In fact, you can connect as many as 1008 slave devices. For me, I2C is a communication protocol to extract the data from any peripheral devices or ICs. It is something similar like UART or USB device. For more details on that, you can visit the link in the description below. Overall concept is complex, but for my project, I need to know that every I2C devices has 4 pins for wiring: VCC, ground, STA, SCL. VCC and ground are the power supply of the device. VCC is the positive power supply voltage and GND stands for ground. SCL and STA are the data lines of the I2C protocol. SCL stands for serial clock, STA stands for serial data. In Beano 055, if I closely look at the board, I'll be able to see the 4 pins which I will connect with my Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi supports this interface on its GPIO headers. GPIO stands for General Purpose Input Output, and it is a great way to connect sensors and devices. Once configured, I can connect more than one devices without using up additional pins on the header. Raspberry Pi has got total 40 pins GPIO, but for my project I only need 4 pins. Those are same like Beano 055, VCC, ground, STA and SCL. As per Raspberry Pi pin descriptions, I will use pin 1 for VCC, pin 6 for ground, pin 3 for STA and pin 5 for SCL. Before I go ahead and connect the cables, let me set up the I2C communication in my Raspberry Pi first. The default Raspbian image disable I2C by default, so before I can use it, the interface must be enabled. This can be done using either of two methods. I will use the quicker and easier method. From the command line or the terminal window, start by running sudo raspi config. Then select interface option and then select P5I2C option and activate it. Once activated, reboot the Pi. Now I will install Python Simbus and I2C tool to access the I2C interface. Once the installation is completed, I will reboot it again. Now I will test it. My Raspberry Pi is ready. I will connect Beano 055 with my Raspberry Pi. For that, I need to understand the I2C cable color code to maintain the standards. I am using red for VCC, which is to supply voltage, black for ground, green for STA and yellow for SCL. Throughout my project, I will maintain the same color coding. Now I'll complete the circuit and then power up my Raspberry Pi. On connected, let's execute the same command to see I2C connection. Now I can see my Beano 055 in my I2C connection of Raspberry Pi, which is addressed at default 28. This looks my connection is successful and it is working. Now let's extract the data from the sensor. For that, I will download a Python package from Adafruit. Link is there in the description below. Once the package is downloaded, I will write a small Python code to quickly test that. At first, import the library to use it. The driver takes an instantiated and active I2C object as an argument to its constructor. The way to create an I2C object depends on the board. For Raspberry Pi, the board is already labeled with SCL and STA pins. I am importing the board directly and then creating an I2C object. Now I have the I2C object, so let's create the sensor object. And then let's start reading the measurement data, temperature, Euler, gravity, accelerometer, all the data. Now I will transfer the Python code into a file so that I can run the data extraction in a loop. You can find the source code in my Patreon site. Link is there in the description below. You can see the variety of the data is being extracted from the sensor. Those are temperature, accelerometer, magnetometer, gyroscope, Euler angle, quaternion, linear accelerations and gravity. And the data is changing on changing the orientation of the sensor. Now let's look at the acceleration data only. Accelerometer sensor are ICs that measures the acceleration, which is the change in speed or velocity per unit time. Measuring acceleration makes it possible to obtain information such as object inclination and vibration. M per a square is the international unit for the acceleration. An international unit expresses the units of length, m for mass, which is the kg, and time, which is s, or we can call it mks. G is used as unit of the acceleration. It is related to the standard gravity. 1g is equivalent to 9.80665 m/s². Acceleration of an object caused by the gravity, it represents the acceleration per unit of time an object falls when dropped. For more details, check the link below about the accelerometer. Here I can see the value around 9 on z-axis when my BNO055 is slide on the flat surface, which is due to the gravity. It means the initial behavior is pretty good. Every orientation sensor needs to be calibrated so that it calculates the correct acceleration considering the gravity in its specific location on the Earth. The primary reason of choosing BNO055 sensor, it is faster to calibrate. To check the calibration, let's print the calibration status to the console. The calibration status printed in an order, which is at first it is system, then gyro, then accelerometer, and then magnetometer. The values are 0 means uncalibrated and 3 means fully calibrated. Gyro calibration is fast. Now if I rotate the board 45 degree and 90 degree on XYZ axis, after complete the rotation on each direction, all the three sensors and the system is now fully calibrated. Now let's try all the data points sequential to see how it affects after calibration. From the data printed on the console, it is very difficult to conclude either my sensor output is perfect and ready to be used, unless I visualize this data in a graph. Due to gravity, there will be always some kind of a drip or noise, and hence it is important to filter those noise to make our sensor foolproof and ready to use. In the next video, I will try to plot this data into a graph to see the precision of the data. So far, what I have done is, I created a circuit using Adafruit BNO055 orientation sensor and Raspberry Pi 02W and written a small Python code to extract the data from the sensor, which I have printed on the console. That's all from this video. I hope you like the process and the progress and the strategy of the development. Please stay tuned for such interesting topic and the solution. Till then, stay safe and take care. Thank you for watching.